ChatGPT for stock research is the topic of today's presentation. And if you've thought about using ChatGPT to research stocks, not pick stocks, but to research them, then you'll want to watch this presentation, as that's what we tried to do. And this particular research assignment related to this series of articles you see here, where we look at the stocks that are found in common amongst the two largest robotics ETFs out there, and there happens to be 18 of them, and then we take that list and we start doing research as to the pure play exposure that you're getting from each of these companies. So it's a series of articles that you can see here, where we've dug into firms like ABB and Fanuc, Yaskawa, and then the remainder of the names that we have left, those are what we wanted to look at. So the use cases for ChatGPT that we were thinking about: calculating a simple valuation ratio for a series of stocks. So you can actually teach ChatGPT ratios. So we taught it our simple valuation ratio, which is market cap divided by annualized revenues, and it made a minor mistake in the formula. We corrected that and it was fine. The only problem is that it can only grab data prior to 2021. So it's rather useless in a lot of use cases, but we can overlook that and pretend that if it was real-time data, then that would be a useful use case for it to do. Another task that we perform all the time, and that was the focus of this article, was to determine the purity for any given stock based on revenue. So you're trying to make sure that the exposure that you're getting is what you think you're getting, which is exposure to robotics, right? Calculating compound annual growth rate, gross margins, runways. Again, these things are only going to be useful if they use recent data. Now, a particularly useful use case for ChatGPT would be to parse SEC filing documents for useful information. So we found that at some point it may make sense to put a constraint on where this tool can go, where it looks for data, because we certainly came across some data problems. Well, here's the first example. Before even starting down the path of research, I just asked it, give me five mid-cap robotics stocks. That's the name of the research piece that we produced, and it pulled up five names here. These are all interesting companies. We've covered each and every one of these. However, Teradyne isn't a mid-cap. Teradyne is a large cap, according to the definition that they give us here, which is that a mid-cap ought to be between $2 billion and $10 billion. And the most egregious error you can see here, of course, is ABB. So I asked it shortly after it gave me this list, is ABB a mid-cap robotics stock? And it told me that it's a large cap. So why it was confused there, I don't know. Now, the next thing I asked it to do is to give me market caps. Again, we know that these market caps are going to be old, but I wanted to see if it could pull up market caps for these five firms that we're talking about in this research piece. And it said, sure, here you go. And Tekken Group there at the top, that's not a $20 billion firm. That's about a $5 billion firm. So I told it no. I said Tekken Group market cap is $5 billion. Check Google. Now, of course, it's going to pull that market cap prior to the 2021 cutoff date. But here it says, I apologize for the confusion. It appears there was a misunderstanding in our previous communication. And strangely enough here, it then pulls a recent date from Google Finance. So it actually goes out and looks, apparently, and it pulls back the correct market cap. And I asked it, well, why did you make that mistake? And then it gives you the usual bog standard spiel about how it misinterpreted something. Now, the other thing that I asked it to do, which was fairly useful here, you can see, is to calculate the compound annual growth rate. I usually do this in Excel using the RRI function, and I need to go get that data. There's a number of sites out there that have it, that I need to throw it into a spreadsheet. And here it did it quite handily, of course, only going up to 2020, the available data set. But it calculated that correctly, and it even showed its work. So that's quite useful. Now, Another question that it ran into problems with, and part of this can be attributed to the fact that the data here that you see along the top, this is for Tekken Group, this is their total addressable market, so the total opportunity in front of them. And when I asked this question to ChatGPT, it went out and got some data from markets and markets and research and markets. And it doesn't know any better, but these estimates by third-party research firms in Mumbai are useless. And there's actually been a bit of a study or a investigative journalist piece on just how bad these research report shops are in Mumbai. They're research farms that just churn out any old number and sell it because they know if they can just get one sale, it's thousands of dollars. And these firms approach us all the time trying to get us to sell their research reports. It doesn't matter if they're right or wrong. Nobody's going to go back and check. So you'll find wild estimates in terms of how much they vary. So in this case, you'd want to limit ChatGPT and tell it not to utilize market estimates from external sources coming out of Mumbai. It's better to go to company sources, and it actually did that quite well here for Intuitive Surgical. So we asked it the total addressable market, and it correctly said that it largely depends on adoption and acceptance of robotic surgery within the medical community, as well as regulatory and reimbursement factors. Well done, right? And then it said, well, minimally invasive surgery is estimated to be around $30 billion. The company estimates that the total addressable market for Da Vinci is approximately $15 billion. Great job. So it pulled the TAM from the company, and we'd assume that the company did their homework. Now, what we also found was that it seems like the bigger and more popular the company, the more likely it is to be able to produce really useful stuff. So we asked it about NVIDIA's historical data center. Again, a bit off topic, but curious because we did this work and it was a little bit time consuming where we had to go figure out the quarterly revenues for NVIDIA's data center segment. You can see those on the right here, and it pulled those up in seconds. I did a spot check. It appears those are correct. So perhaps the larger the company, the more likely it is to give correct answers. Now, here we asked it. Renishaw was one of the firms that we covered in this research piece, and they happened to do additive manufacturing. So I asked it, well, for Renishaw, how much of the revenues are coming from additive manufacturing? This would be difficult to find, I know, because I tried to find it and I couldn't. And it says, well, approximately 20% of total revenues. I was quite surprised. I wasn't able to find that. So I said, do you have a source? And it says, I apologize for the mistake in my previous response. Upon checking, I was unable to find any recent of it. Sure, exactly. I wasn't either. So then it goes on to say that, well, their annual report talks about how metrology accounts for this number when total revenue is this number, and that suggests that additive manufacturing may have accounted for a significant portion of their revenue in that year. Now, that's incorrect. You can't tell, based on the information this firm gives, whether or not additive manufacturing was significant or not. So it's lied the first time, and the second time it misled me. So at this point, it's a matter of trust. If I have to spot check, or let's say check everything that comes out of ChatGPT, then it's useless, whether that's checking all the data or spot checking, because something might get through and we're ultimately responsible for what we publish. So another example here was when I asked it if Renishaw did any work in robotics. It was somewhat useful here. It mentioned the fact that Renishaw did, and Google searches showed something similar. But it said here that Renishaw also offers a range of collaborative robots, cobots. I said, well, that's interesting. So I said, do you have a link to an article that talks about these cobots? Because I couldn't find anything. And then it goes on to say, well, I don't provide links. Of course, it can't it doesn't seem to provide sources, which is a problem, and you would need that for it to be of any use. It says Renishaw's cobots are based on the Fanuc CRX series of CoLab robots. Well, there you go. So they don't actually make the cobots. They're simply using them. So it would have been nice to have more information on that. But, and of course, it says I recommend visiting their official website or contacting the company, of course. And then, you know, when it comes to writing, I played around a little bit with this, and it's not very clever. It's not a very good writer. So I said, write a very interesting intro to an article on robotics stocks in the style of Nanalyze. So it knew about Nanalyze. It actually was able to describe what we do very well, and I even used part of that for some collateral that we're creating for the Chinese market. But so it says, sure, here's an intro in the style of Nanalyze, and it's just useless. So it repeats itself. This is what you would expect from a graduate a journalism student or somebody that hasn't spent a lot of time writing. You need the 10,000 hours to actually write interesting things. You can see here, there's always something new and exciting happening. Tell me what I don't know. The pace of innovation in this field is simply astounding. Plenty of opportunities to get on the action. The market for robotic stocks is vast and varied. It's just rubbish, useless. If somebody gave you this paragraph, I'd tell them to rewrite it because it just doesn't provide any insights. It's not very interesting. The actual intro that we did is somewhat interesting here, I think. We talk about automation in Japan. That's where I'm at right now. This picture was taken some hours ago in the cafe that I went, and that's a little robot that's delivering food to everybody's table. So you never actually interact with a human. You order from the little pad on the table, and then this robot brings you your food. And then when I got home, I pressed a button on the thermostat, and it drew me a bath in the bathtub. So you set it to the temperature that you like and the level that you like. You press the button, it sings you a little song when your bath is ready and tells you to go in there and take a bath. And it will also, there's a button next to that that will reheat the bath water. That's because the Japanese don't actually take baths as we do in the Western world. They take a shower before the bath, and the bath is simply meant to relax and enjoy the water. So you just leave the water in there, and you can press another button, and it'll heat it back up and let you know when you can go in and take a bath. Now, that's interesting because the country is so dramatically different culturally that their technological use cases don't apply to most other cultures. It also means that because it's so culturally different, investing in their companies is very difficult because they don't have the same metrics, even the same goals that we do in the Western world. So investing in Japanese companies as a foreigner isn't easy. So that's an example of something relevant, an intro that teaches the reader something useful. And I was looking for something of interest from ChatGPT. I tried to prod it a bit, and it was all but useless. Now, one thing it seems to be quite good at, I had asked it about our coming portfolio review webinar, where we go over a section of our tech stock portfolio and talk about the companies contained within. That's for premium subscribers. And last time we held the call, the meeting time was off, and it was, you know, quite late for people in Europe, and it just wasn't right. So I asked ChatGPT to tell me the best time, and indeed it figured that out correctly. The best time is either 9 or 10 a.m. San Francisco time. That's pretty much nails it for an evening in Europe and around lunchtime in New York. So it is useful, and we're, you know, trying to figure out the usefulness for our organization, not just for doing research, but how we can use it to, you know, create basic copy for YouTube playlists, for example. There's a lot of things that it's useful for. But in terms of doing proper stock or equity research, it has a long way to go. And certainly, some of the more major problems could be easily fixed. So we'll look forward to seeing what manifestation comes out that's useful. A model that's fine-tuned for financial applications, such as what Bloomberg has produced, and that's probably subscription-only, is highly desirable. The ability to parse 10 Qs and 10 Ks on demand would be great. We do that all the time. Some of the information needs to be recent, as of last market session, things like market caps and stock prices. the tools would be extremely valuable to our research efforts if the results could be accurate, sourced, and therefore trusted. So we'll continue to keep an eye on this space. One observation here would be that this will lead to a massive amount of rubbish, quote-unquote, content that's being pushed out there. So true, real insights will just become rarer over time, of course, until this tool becomes capable of actually providing useful insights. So I put up another video here on the best AI stocks, some research that has not been produced by AI. But before you click that, please subscribe by clicking the Nanalyze logo here on the right. Support our channel. Thanks for taking the time to watch this today.